Caitlin Elam, and I'm here to talk to you today about victimology and how it integrates with psychology. The first thing we need to look at is the actual definition of the word victimology, which is the study of victims of a crime and the psychological effects on them of their experience. It's worthy to note that the definition of victimology actually has the word psychology in it, and that tells you how closely linked the two things. What we're going to look at now is psychology, and the basic definition of psychology is a scientific study of the human mind and its functions, especially those affecting behavior in a given context. There are three stages to victimization, the first of which is the impact stage. It occurs immediately after the crime. The victims feel as if they are in shock. Some cannot eat or sleep. Others express disbelief that the crime even occurred. The episode can last for several hours to several days, depending upon the victim and the crime. The episodes also highlight severe mood swings. They're very susceptible to the influence of others, and innocent statements made to them could be misconstrued by them as being victim-blaming, or blaming the victim for the crime itself. What we have next is the recoil stage, and overall this is when the victims start dealing with their feelings. Some examples are dreaming about it, talking about it, or not talking about it at all, or outright denying that it ever happened. In order for victims to move forward, they must verbalize their fears and other emotions to be able to begin healing. This recoil stage also adds in their thoughts towards the criminal, anger, revenge, especially those who have suffered from a violent attack. Victims must understand that the desire for revenge is a natural and normal part of the healing process. Many victims want to construct a reason for their victimization. These victims search for the answer to the question, why me? The very last stage is the reorganization stage, and this is when the victim moves towards a more balanced state. They're able to confront life and daily activities with a more normalized behavior. They have less of a need to deny that the victimization or the crime actually occurred. They're able to put their experiences into perspective and deal in the present. We have mental conditions associated with victimization, the first being acute stress disorder. It is usually immediately after a traumatic event, and the anxiety, dissociative symptoms, and other manifestations that occur within 1 month after exposure to the traumatic event. The event is a threatened death or serious injury or threat to the physical safety of the victim or others. The victim's response must involve intense fear, helplessness, or horror. This diagnosis requires that 3 of the 5 post-traumatic stress disorder or PTSD symptoms be present, as well as the symptoms must persist for at least 2 days but last no more than 30. What we have next is post-traumatic stress disorder. It's also called PTSD. It follows the psychologically distressing event that is outside the range of usual human experience. Some examples of this are military combat, violent personal assault, which includes rape, child molestation or sexual assault, and child abuse, terrorist attacks, torture, incarceration as a prisoner of war, natural or man-made disasters, severe automobile accidents, kidnapping and hostage victim situations, or being diagnosed with a life-threatening illness. Symptoms include re-experiencing the event in terms of flashbacks, avoidance of all stimuli associated with the event, a numbing of general responsiveness, and increased agitation. Victims of any type of crime can experience PTSD, and it is definitely something that should be watched out for vigilantly by psychological professionals. Next is long-term crisis reaction, or LTCR. It's a condition that occurs when victims do not suffer from PTSD, but they may re-experience feelings of the crisis reaction when certain events trigger the recollection of the trauma in their lives. That includes anniversaries of the crisis, birthdays, holidays of loved ones lost during the trauma, significant life events, marriage, divorce, births, graduations. Also when media events broadcast the event and involvement in the criminal justice system and legal proceedings. Other mental disorders that are included with victimization are depression and substance abuse. Other victimization concerns include financial concerns such as paying for a lawyer, paying for funeral expenses, paying for medical bills, social in terms of what other people will think or feel about the victim after the event, emotional, which ties into the psychological element, and physical, which means, especially after a physical attack, how the victim will be able to go on the day-to-day in normal physical condition. What re-victimization is when the victim who has already gone through a traumatic ordeal feels like they're being victimized yet again by the system that they have come to for help. This could include lawyers, it could include psychologists, social workers, police officers, investigators, and anybody in the criminal justice proceedings. To avoid this, one in any of these criminal justice or social work positions needs to be aware of the conditions that happen to a person and the reaction, both physically and psychologically, after a traumatic event. And once you start to realize those events and validate them as real, you can start to avoid re-victimization of a victim, which can be very devastating to the victim and make them very hesitant to come forward. As Sundborg points out, victims of a crime play a central role in the judicial system, typically providing information critical to criminal investigations. Crime victims are also often particularly vulnerable, and if met inappropriately by legal actors and the public, may experience a secondary victimization. This is what I was pointing out earlier in terms of re-victimization or secondary victimization, where the victim feels as if they are being victimized yet again by the system. And in order to avoid this and to avoid hurting the victim further or traumatizing them further, one needs to be cognizant of the psychological implications of the crime and the psychological implications of how the victim is treated after the crime. In conclusion, it's clear to see how psychology can affect victimology and vice versa, and how they play off of one another, and how when you use psychology, you can not only identify risk factors in victims, but use those risk factors to avoid re-victimization and also to get them proper help. It also helps with investigators and lawyers during the judicial proceedings in order to glean facts, in order to prosecute the criminals fully and to the full extent of the law. When we acknowledge what victims go through psychologically, then we can start to help jumpstart healing and make it a smoother process for all involved.
Come, when you pull my key, I can do my time. Since when my feet show.